First of all, I would like to say thank you for joining us this evening in regards to the subject matter. Will there be a rapture? And we would like to go through some points in the Bible, amen, to see if there's going to be a rapture. So at this time, let us have a word of prayer and ask God to bless us. Heavenly, kind, and gracious Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for all things. We thank you for your goodness. We thank you for your mercy. We thank you for what you're doing for us, Lord God. We realize how insufficient we are of ourselves. We ask that you would bless this evening. We need your help, O God, that you would bless us in regards to the subject matter, O God, and we will address, amen, the issues of this time, Lord God. So just bless us, have your way. We thank you. We commit ourselves into your hands this evening in Jesus' name. Amen. This is our first time trying to broadcast our webcast simultaneously. So pray for us. Sometimes you got to work out all the bugs, but God knows, and he'll bless us. All right, then. So I want you to turn your Bibles to 1 Thessalonians, 4th chapter. 1 Thessalonians, the 4th chapter. And starting at the 16th verse. All right. Now the issue of this day is the sign of Jesus coming. Today, which is September the 23rd, 2017, it is said and is broadcast, amen, all over the world that the world would end this day. But guess what? We're still here. Amen. And I don't know of any Christians that has been taken and some that is left. And by the grace of God, we live into all that we know. Amen. And I look forward to the coming of Jesus Christ. And I'm sure many Christians out there as well look forward to the coming of Jesus Christ. So we're going to address this with our main scripture. Amen. It says here in 1 Thessalonians 4:16, "For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with the shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. Wherefore, comfort one another with these words." Amen. So here it is. We have the Apostle Paul, who left this on records that we as Christians may be encouraged and that we will look forward to the coming of the Lord. Amen. And it should be a time of comfort. Why you say comfort? Because, see, if we're living right, amen, we have the confidence that, amen, when he come, we will go to be with him. So as we go through this PowerPoint presentation, we ask that you kind of move along with us. Amen. And we want to address that. All right. Now, this theory is so big, amen, that it cannot be addressed in one webcast. But we're going to, amen, do our best to lay a foundation, and we're going to address some of it, amen. And this will continue until hopefully we've addressed all of it, all right? So there are many false end time theories that surround the second coming of Jesus Christ. The following topics are the rapture of the church, the first resurrection, the great tribulation, the Antichrist, the destruction of the temple, the battle of Armageddon, the second coming of Christ, the millennium reign, the second resurrection, the kingdom of God, and the throne of David and the destruction of the earth. There are multiple doctrinal views concerning that. They got Jesus going and coming, and There's just so many theories. Amen. There has also have been a series called the Left Behind series, where there has been movies. In other words, Hollywood has jumped in on this as well, so to speak. Amen. And there was a Left Behind series by Tim LaHaye. I don't know if any of you all have seen it. I've never seen one of them. Amen. But the false signs and prediction of Jesus coming, amen, are everywhere. In 2011, there was a prediction made back then, amen, of his coming. All right? And there was a prediction today of the destruction of the earth, and this will be the end. So we're going to start with series one, the rapture. All right? Will there be a secret rapture? Amen. That is the stealing away of all the believers in Christ. Amen. That they will be caught up, swept to heaven, and those that are not saved will be left here on the earth. All right? Now, here is one of the propagators of that theory, and I'm sure many of you all, if you watch television, have seen this man many times on TV. His name is John Hagee, all right? John Charles Hagee, who was born in 1940, amen, and he has a broadcast that he feature a lot of his prophecy theories. He's the pastor of the Cornerstone Church, a mega church in San Antonio, Texas. He is also the CEO of his nonprofit corporation, Global Evangelism Television, all right? So this is the chart that he teaches from. If you can see here, you see the church age, you see the tribulation period, you see the 1,000-year millennium range, and then you see the new heaven and earth. This is John Hagee's rapture chart. What John Hagee teaches. All right, he used the same scripture that we just read, amen, to build his theories upon. But you know, the Bible says, amen, study, amen, to show thyself approved, a workman that need not be ashamed. The Bible said, whom shall he make to understand knowledge? Whom shall he make to understand doctrine? But them that are weaned from the milk, for precept must be upon precept, line upon line, and here a little and there a little. The problem is that many people take one scripture, pull it out of context, amen, and they build a theory off of it. Now, this is what he's saying. We're going to live in a literal city, all right? Where roses never fade, where tears never fall from the eyes of a believer, from a city that has never heard the word goodbye or farewell, and this sounds good, that has never known the spirit of fear, where we can walk on streets of gold, live in mansions designed by the architect of ages, that's just about to happen in the twinkling of an eye. Matter of fact, he said, and I took my time. I sat down and I listened to his whole sermon from start to finish to find out exactly what he propagated, because you don't want to be falsely accusing somebody of teaching something, amen, that they didn't teach. But I wrote down, amen, all the points that he made verbatim, so we can have a thorough understanding of what he's teaching and what is being propagated today. All right, he also teaches the rapture, that it is the Bible basis, amen, for the rapture of the church. That is his theory. And he uses John 14, 2 and 1. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it was not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. He uses 1 Corinthians, amen, 15:51, in a moment, in a twinkling of an eye. In other words, it's quicker than you can bat your eye that we would be called away or we would be changed. Note, the word rapture is not found in any biblical text. Now, this is what he's saying. He says also the word Trinity and homosexual is not found in the Bible. He says that the Bible is a book of words, picture. Well, see, this is the thing. There's a little truth in this. Amen. But if you can see how much, amen, the error is. See, God doesn't mix truth with a lie. God is not man. God doesn't lie. Amen. And the Bible harmonizes, amen, one scripture with the other scripture. The Bible said no prophecy of, amen, the no prophecy is of the scriptures of any private interpretation. It didn't come in old time by the will of man, but holy men of God who spake as they were moved by the Holy Ghost. You have 40 different writers of the Bible from different eras of time, and yet the scriptures harmonize. Amen. So here it is. That's what we want to take, amen, this theory and put it in the light of the Bible. The Bible said, beloved, believe not every spirit, but try the spirits to see whether they be of God. Well, how are you going to try it? You got to try them by the word. Put it to test. Okay, will there be a rapture? All right. As I said, he's teaching from 1 Thessalonians 4:16. He's saying that the Lord shall descend from heaven with a shout. The trumpet in the Bible is used to announce the appearance of royalty. I'm laying down what he teaches first. That's only fair to do. The word mystery means a truth that has never been revealed. It is a divine revelation, all right? What is the rapture? Amen. What is the rapture? The rapture of the church, it is the first phase of Christ's return. When the rapture happens, the trump of God shall sound. He also says he will descend from heaven to earth. He will stay in the clouds. He will bring with him the perfected spirits of believers who have died. At the same instant, he will resurrect bodies, and their bodies shall be joined with their spirits, and they shall go to heaven. All right? And he goes on and on and on. He also says that these things are going to take place when the rapture comes. What will happen at the rapture? He says cars will be empty beside the freeway. The cars will be running and the occupants will be gone. People will be strangely missing for mansions in the sky because they went to their mansions in the sky. Homes of believers will have the dinner dishes on the table. The food is on the stove. The occupants are gone to the marriage supper of the Lamb. Snatched away from this madhouse called earth to the paradise that God has created for them that love him. Headlines will be screaming tomorrow. Millions are missing. Christians have disappeared from the earth. In a few short days, there will be an economic crash because the Christians have gone and there will be no one to go to work or no one else to work. TV cameras will go into the cemeteries of the world. Now, what's so funny, this is a man-made theory, all right? And all those bullet points I just read to you, I never found them in the Bible. Note, most end time teachings center around the following, all right? As I said, the rapture of the church, the great tribulation, the Antichrist, or the man of sin, the mark of the beast, they teach that the gospel will be preached again during the tribulation, then there's a battle of Armageddon, the nation of Israel will be restored, the second coming of Christ will happen, then the resurrection, then the millennium reign, which Christ will come down and set up his kingdom on earth and reign 1,000 years, and the new Jerusalem. All right. Now, my question to you is, what do you believe? And see, when they teach this rapture, they use scriptures like Matthew 24:40-41. Then shall two be in the field, the one shall be taken and the other left. Two women shall be grinding at the mill, the one shall be taken and the other left. In other words, she's gone, all right? He is the one that was left behind. Now, my question is, what do you believe? What do you think the Bible teaches in regards to the rapture? Let us see. First of all, the theory that he's coming as a thief in the night is a big lie, because that's not what the scripture says. Let's go there. Let's turn to Acts 1 and 9, if you will. Let's let our fingers do the walking. Pray for me that God will bless. Amen. Listen to what 1 and 9 says. And when he had spoken these words, while they beheld, he was taken up, and a cloud received him out of their sight. All right? So here it is. He is not stealing anybody away. How do you know? Let's go. Continue to read, brother. It says here in the 10th verse, and while they looked steadfastly towards heaven as he went up, behold, two men stood by them in white apparel, which also said, ye men of Galilee, why stand ye gazing up into heaven? This same Jesus, which is taken up from you into heaven, shall so come in a like manner as you have seen him, amen, go into heaven. So, in other words, this is not going to be a secret. Amen. When he appeared in the sky, he's not coming, amen, and where nobody could see him, all right? So let's use it. I'll go to another scripture, Revelation 1 and 7. I thought it would be a good time to address this issue since the issue is out here. He said, behold, Revelation 1 and 7, he cometh with clouds, and every eye shall see him, and they also which pierced him. All kindreds of the earth shall wail because of him. Even so, amen. Now the scripture specifically say, every eye shall see him. Now does that sound like amen? The people were being stolen away or raptured secretly? All right. What does the word rapture mean? The word rapture is not found in the Bible. Most frequent reference used, then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. Well, if you pull out some of the commentaries and you do your research on them, amen, you'll find that for the most part, it's a Greek word. It means to seize or catch away, to pluck, to pull, to take by force, okay? Now, so when the scripture is using the term, he shall come as a thief in the night, that is more so, amen, an expression of how quick he would come. Now, when a thief is going to come to your house, he doesn't announce when he's coming, but you'll know when he's gone because your stuff will be gone. Well, so it is when it's talking about Christ coming as a thief in the night, it has reference to his coming. In other words, you don't know when he's coming. It has no reference to, amen, the souls of men being stolen away secretly. All right. There are five certified accounts of the rapture recorded in the scripture, or where the term caught up, amen, or plucked up was used. So let's look at some of those terms, amen. Because number one, what's going to happen on that day has already happened, amen, or examples of it, I should say, has already happened, and we can find them in the scriptures. Let's look here. The rapture of Enoch, Genesis 5:24. Let's go there. Go back to the beginning of your Bibles. Amen. It says, and Enoch walked with God, and he was not, for God what? All right. In other words, Enoch, he never saw death. Amen. He never, his body never was decayed. He never was buried. God took him straight to heaven. All right. Now, the second, amen, account of a rapture or anyone being called away was Elijah. Let's go there. 2 Kings, the second chapter. All right. It says, and it came to pass when the Lord, that's 2 Kings 2 and 1, and it came to pass when the Lord would take up Elijah into heaven by a whirlwind, that Elijah went with Elisha from Gilgal. And Elijah said unto Elisha, tarry here, I pray thee, for the Lord has sent me to Bethel. And Elisha said unto him, as the Lord liveth, and as thy soul liveth, I will not leave thee. So they went down to Bethel. Well, if you're familiar with that story, you knew how he was called up, amen, to heaven in a whirlwind. All right? Here's another account, the third account, the rapture of Jesus. In other words, when Jesus was called up. And we read some of it. Let's go back, amen, to Acts, the first chapter. Amen. And the ninth verse. Listen. And when he had spoken these things, while they beheld, he was what? Taken up. And a cloud received him out of their sight. And while they looked steadfastly towards heaven as he went up, behold, two men stood by them in white apparel, which also said, ye men of Galilee, why stand ye here gazing up into heaven? This same Jesus, which is what? Taken up, amen, from you into heaven, shall so come in like manner as you have seen him go into heaven. So that's an example. And I'm so glad, amen, that he left on records many accounts, amen, of a person, amen, making his transition from earth to heaven without seeing death, all right? The fourth account, the rapture of St. Paul. Let's turn there. 2 Corinthians, the 12th chapter. Here's another instance where the apostle himself, amen, the same term, the same word, which is used, and here's a beautiful example. It says here, 12 and 1, it is not expedient for me, doubtless, to glory. I will come to visions and revelations of the Lord. I knew a man in Christ above 14 years ago. Whether in the body, I cannot tell, or whether out of the body, I cannot tell. God knoweth, such an one called up, where? To the third heaven. Amen. Now, that's another example. Now, the last example, amen, in the Bible that I would like to give, actually, there's two. Let's go there. 1 Thessalonians, 4th chapter. That's the initial scripture that we started off with. 4:16. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel and the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up, amen, together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. So here it is. He when he comes, he's never going to put his foot down here on the earth. We're going to be caught up. Amen. The dead in the grave. Amen. And we which are alive who are on the earth, we are all going to be caught up together to meet him in the clouds in the air. All right? Let's go to 1 Corinthians 15:51. See, the Bible, it harmonizes. Amen. Whom shall he make to understand doctrine? You have to go here a little and there a little. So 1 Corinthians, bear with me as I go there. And you're more than welcome to weigh in on it. All right. 1 Corinthians. 15:51. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed in a moment, in a twinkling of an eye, at the last trump. Amen. This is the same trump, amen, that was sounding, amen, in 1 Thessalonians, amen, the 4th chapter. So here it is. We see the resurrection taking place, and you see those that are caught up. So here it is. We can see that the rapture being caught up and the resurrection, they're both going to transpire at the same time. They're going to happen at the same time. All right? Now, so here it is, the rapture of the church, 1 Corinthians 15:51, the general resurrection. All right, let's move on. What did Jesus say concerning this? The prophecy of Jesus concerning the nation of Israel, and these issues was addressed. Hold on just a moment. I'm sorry, I had to answer the door. Come on in, Sister Carolyn. All right. Good. You can help me read just in time. All right. The prophecy of Jesus concerning the nation of Israel. Amen. And the disciple asked a three-part question. This is where we at. Let's go there. Matthew's the 24th chapter. Bear with me as I go there. And Jesus went out, Matthew 24:1, and departed from the temple, and his disciples came to him for to show him the building of the temple. And Jesus said unto them, see ye not all these things? Verily I say unto you, there shall not be left here one stone upon another that shall not be thrown down. All right, as he was taking a tour of the temple, amen, they were showing him all the beauty and how beautiful Herod's temple was, all right? So Jesus informed them, there shall not be left here one stone upon another. In other words, this temple is going to be destroyed. And when you look at verse 3, it said, and as he sat upon the Mount of Olives, the disciples came unto him privately, amen, and they asked a three-part question. Tell us, when shall these things be, and what shall be the sign of thy coming and of the end of the world? So it's three things the disciples or the church want to know from Jesus. In other words, when shall these things be? What shall be the sign of your coming? Amen. And tell me, when is the end of the world? All right, so let's see what Jesus says. As we see here, when shall these things be? The first question, this here addressed the deception or the apostasy that was going to affect the church, amen, in its early conception. So if you turn here in Matthew, the 24th chapter again, and let's read on a little more. Jesus said in the 4th verse, take heed that no man deceive you, for many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. And you shall hear wars and rumors of wars. See that ye be not troubled, for all these things must come to pass, but the end is not yet. So this is a three-part question. And he's beginning to address just the first part. Amen. He said, but the end is not yet. Why? Some things must take place. What are those things? For a nation shall rise against nation, the kingdom against kingdom, and there shall be famine, pestilence, and earthquakes in divers or different places. And all these things, or rather, all these are the beginning of sorrow. Okay. Then shall they deliver you up to be afflicted, which had reference to the persecution. Amen, of the early church. Amen. But not only just the early church, but the persecution of Christians, period. All right? Start reading for me. Amen. At the 8th verse.
All these are the beginning of sorrow.
All these are just the beginning of sorrow. Go on.
Then shall they deliver you up to be afflicted.
Yes.
And shall kill you. And ye shall be hated of all nations for my name's sake.
Uh-huh.
And then shall many be offended and shall betray one another. And shall hate one another. And many false prophets shall rise.
In other words, there's going to be many false prophets. They're going to arise. Go on.
And shall deceive many.
And look, we're living in a time now where many are truly under the very spirit of deception. Go on.
And because iniquity shall abound, the love of many shall wax cold.
Wax cold.
But he that shall endure until the end, the same shall be saved.
Uh-huh.
And this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for a witness unto all nations. And then shall the end come.
So here it is. He's addressing these three-part questions. The first one was, tell us, when shall these things be? In other words, what are these things are going to take place? What shall be the sign of thy coming? And what shall be the end of the world? So he gives him a general description. All right? Moving on. Question two. What shall be the sign of thy coming? That's the second part of that question. The answer, when we see the sign of the abomination of desolation, spoken of in Matthew's, the 24th chapter, which is the chapter we're in right now, starting at the 15th verse. What does it say?
When ye therefore shall see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet, stand in the holy place. Who shall read it, let him understand.
All right, now this was a period. Amen. This was a period, amen, when the temple, amen, and Jerusalem was going to be destroyed. The Romans came and destroyed the temple there, all right? This was the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet. First of all, Moses spoke of the abomination. Amen.
Amen.
He said that if the Jews, amen, did not, amen, live right, amen, and worship God, amen, like he had commanded them, they were going to be destroyed and scattered to every nation under the sun. And that actually took place. If you read Deuteronomy, the 28th chapter, that is the chapter of the curses and the blessings. Amen. The blessings is when you obey God. Amen. The curses is those things you bring upon yourself when you disobey God.
Amen.
All right. So here it is. They begin to fulfill prophecy. All right. And it goes on to say in the 13th verse, but he that shall endure unto the end, the same shall be saved. And this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for a witness unto all nations, and then shall the end come. So all of these things were to take place. So most of these false theories out here that are floating around, amen, that God is going to rebuild the temple or the nation of Israel going to be destroyed, All of those things, amen, has already happened for the most part. Okay, you with me? Let's go here. All right. Now, if you notice here, the abomination of desolation, that is the destruction of the temple. That happened in AD 70. As I said, most all of that has already taken place. All right? That's when the Romans came. And they surrounded the city of Jerusalem. Nobody could go in and nobody could go out. Moses had already said in Genesis, the 28th chapter, that this, amen, was going to happen, that a nation would come, amen, swift as an eagle from the north, and they would put a siege against the city of Jerusalem, and to the point nobody could go in, nobody could go out, they couldn't receive any food, and guess what happened? They also would become cannibals and eat their own dead. They begin to eat the bodies of their children. Amen. That took place. All right, but see, Jesus gave the Christians during that time in AD 70 a warning sign, and guess what? The Christians left. Amen. They left the city of Jerusalem. Amen. And General Titus, the prince, he came, amen, to Jerusalem. They surrounded it. Amen. And exactly what Moses had said was going to happen, it happened. Amen. And here Jesus is simply saying, even before it took place, that he's quoting what Daniel said. Daniel quoted what Moses said. So all of the prophets, amen, harmonize.
Amen.
All right, but now there are some other things in here that we would like to address, and we can go there. Amen. In the 29th verse, listen to this right here. It says, immediately after the tribulation of those days, speaking of past tense, shall the sun be darkened, and the moon shall not give her light, and the stars shall fall from heaven, and the powers of heaven shall be shaken. Now I can go on, and I don't want to put too much on your plate, because we're going to continue this, but here it is, you have the sun darkened, the moon not giving light, the stars, amen, falling from heaven, and the power of heaven is shaking. All right, these are not natural occurrences, amen. These are occurrences that take place in the spiritual world. How do you know? Let's go there. Let's go to Revelation 12 and 1. And we get a beautiful description of the church. How do you know it's the church? Let's read and see. Revelation 12 and 1.
And there appeared a great wonder in
heaven. There appeared a great wonder in heaven. This is the church. Go on. How do you know? This is the wife of Jesus Christ. Go on.
A woman clothed with the sun.
She was clothed with the sun.
And the moon under her feet.
And the moon was under her feet. Go on.
And upon her head a crown of 12 stars.
12 stars was a representation of the 12 apostles of the Lamb. All right? So he is taking natural things, the things that we physically can see. Amen. But he's bringing out a spiritual meaning. All right? He can do that.
Amen.
It's his teaching. It's his word. All right? So you have the sun, the moon, the stars, and the power of heavens. Well, let me ask you this. How many heavens you think it is? Well, when I read the scripture, I see at least four. Amen. Well, the first heaven is the heaven when you walk out your door. Amen.
Amen.
And you look up. You see a pretty blue sky. Sometimes it's gray. Amen. You see clouds in it. That's the aerial heavens. The second heaven, amen, that we know, amen, is the ecclesiastical heavens. Come on. Amen. Hello. How do you know? Where Jesus is, it is heaven. The Bible said we was raising up from a filthy life of sin and made to sit together in heavenly places where? In Christ Jesus. So this is the heaven where the church exists. Well, what's the third heaven? The third heaven is paradise. Come on, how do you know? We read to you earlier that Paul said, amen, that he was called up to, amen, the third heaven, paradise. Well, how do you get a fourth heaven? Amen. Well, if paradise is a heavenly place, and Paul called it the third heaven, and when you die, that's the place you go, because the thief on the cross, Jesus spoke to him and said, this day you shall be with me where? In paradise. So paradise is the third heaven, Paul said. All right? Well, there's another heaven, and that's the heaven where God is at. Come on. And ain't nobody up there but God, Jesus Christ sitting on his right hand, and his holy angels. Amen. And when Jesus comes back to rapture or to catch up, amen, and bring the bride home and present it to his Father, that is the final heaven.
Amen.
Now, I would say that's the fourth. Hello? Come on. So here it is. When we're talking about heavens all the time, and it ain't talking about something literal. Same way with angels. Come on. Hello. You kind of got to put who, what, where, when. Amen. To analyze who's talking here. What is this talking about? Where is it taking place? Hello. Come on. How many angels? Come on. Well, you have heavenly angels where God is at, but you have some earthly angels, which is God's preachers. Amen. They're styled as angels. And you even have some false angels. Come on. The Bible said, don't marvel not, even Satan himself is transformed as an angel of light. And don't be surprised if his ministers also are transformed as well, as ministers of unrighteousness. So there are more than one type of angels. When John on the island of Patmos wrote his letter, amen, when he wrote his letter, amen, to the churches, guess what? He addressed them unto the angel of what? The church. Hello.
Amen.
Come on, to the angel of the church. Was he talking about a real angel? I never found in the scripture anywhere where Gabriel ever pastored the congregation. He was talking about them that had the heavenly message.
Amen.
And when you look in the book of Revelation, you will find where God gave his angels, seven angels, and seven is the number of completeness. He gave them what? Seven trumpets. Come on.
Amen.
In other words, a complete, amen, gospel message. Trumpets was used back then there to warn the people. So let's look at this again. Immediately after the tribulation of those days, amen, I'm in the 29th verse. Read that for me. Matthew 24:29. Oh, I'm sorry. I want to finish the thought here. Let's go to, sometimes you get to teach and you can't help but to preach it. Revelation, stay right there a moment because I'm going to tie it in with this, 12 and 1. What does it say again?
And there appeared a great wonder in heaven.
There appeared a great wonder in heaven. Go on.
A woman clothed with the sun.
She was clothed with the sun, not the physical sun. Go on.
And the moon under her feet.
Amen. Hosea, I think 4 and 6 says the sun, speaking of Jesus Christ, and his spell, S-U-N, shall arise with healing in his wings.
Yes.
Come on. Christ is the light.
Amen.
He is the gospel light. Amen. So here it is, we see a woman. She's clothed with the sun. And guess what? She's standing where? On the moon. Read
it. And upon her head, a crown of
is a beautiful description of the church. Amen. So if you look at Matthew, the 24th chapter, where people are gathering all of these errors from, it ain't nothing but a mini book of Revelation. Come on. So we see the church. So we see heaven. Amen. That's where she was. She was a great wonder in heaven. We see she was clothed with the sun. We see, amen, that the moon was under her feet. So let's look at the scripture. And then we see a crown of 12 stars on her head. Come on. So here, immediately after the tribulation, he shifts his focus from the Jews back to the church. And he said, immediately after the tribulation of those days, after you see the destruction of Jerusalem, amen, something else is going to happen. The Jews, that destruction came on them because they failed God. They apostatized. Come on. Hello. They apostatized. They brought the tribulation upon themselves when they refused to walk and obey God. But here it is, it says in Matthew, let's go there, the 24th chapter and the 29th verse, it says this. Go ahead.
Immediately after the tribulation of those days.
Immediately after the tribulation of those days.
Shall the sun be darkened.
Listen, the light that the folks had, amen, it became darkness. The Bible said, walk in the light while you have light. Lest darkness come upon you. Come on. Jesus is the light of the world. The gospel is the light.
Amen.
So here it is. Immediately, it says here, immediately after the tribulation of those days shall the sun be darkened. And guess what? The moon. Well, if you know anything, amen, about the sun and the moon, and I'm sure a lot of us was educated of late when we had the total eclipse. How the moon, amen, blocked the sunlight. It lined in a straight order with the sun, therefore causing the light to eclipse.
Yes.
Disappear. Come on. When something eclipses, that's one thing covering or eclipsing another thing.
Amen.
So the moon, amen, is represent the law. It was a shadow of good things. The light you see from the sun, amen, at nighttime, brother, I'm sorry, the moon, when you see it at nighttime and it's all lit up, it's only reflecting the sunlight. So here it is, you see a woman clothed with the sun, amen, and she was standing on the moon, and guess what? She had on her head a crown of 12 stars. So when we get here in the 29th verse, it says, immediately after the tribulation of those days shall the sun be darkened. Amen. The light that she had, amen, it wasn't shining bright. And it said, the moon shall not give her light. Amen. The scripture or the book was slowly closing up. And the stars shall fall from what?
Heaven.
The stars, amen, are representation of God's ministry. And the fact that they fell from heaven, they lost their heavenly position. Amen. Where God had them in truth. And guess what? They failed. They compromised. They let down the standards. They began to let things in. And the stars shall fall from heaven. And guess what? And the powers of heaven shall be shaken. This ain't talking about, amen, where God is at. Come on. It ain't talking about, amen, the aerial heavens, because just as God set, amen, Mars, Pluto, Saturn, and Jupiter, and all those other planets in order, they still in the same place.
Amen.
It ain't talking about the heaven being shaken where he's at. Come on. Because God's unmovable. Well, then, you might say, well, what is shaking? All right, let's go there. Let's go to Hebrews. I think Hebrews, the last part of there was going to come a time, amen, when there's going to be a shaking in the church. Hello. See, anytime you refuse to walk in light or obey truth, there's going to be a shaking going on.
Yes.
Come on.
Amen.
Amen. Sometimes God got to shake things up.
That's right.
Come on. Amen. 12:25, what does it say in Hebrews?
See that ye refuse not him that speaketh.
See that you refuse not him that speaketh. Let me tell you something. When you refuse to obey God, when you refuse to walk in the light, amen, when God is speaking to you, guess what? Something's going to happen. See that you refuse not him that speaketh, for they escape not who refuse him that spake on earth. Much more shall not we escape if we turn away from him that speaketh from where?
Heaven.
Whose voice then shook the earth, and now he is saying, yet once more I shake not the earth, but also what?
Heaven.
Come on. He's shaking. Amen. The church. And this word yet once more signifieth, amen, or symbolize the removing of those things that are shaken, as of things that are made, that those things which cannot be shaken, amen, may remain. God wants us to so stand for this truth, amen, and stand for what the Bible teaches in such a way that we can be unshakable. Wherefore, we receive in a kingdom which cannot be what?
Moved.
Come on.
Amen.
Let us have grace that we might serve God acceptably with reverence and godly fear. All right. So let's go back to the 24th chapter. So here it is. Immediately after the tribulation, which happened in AD 70, amen, which was brought upon the Jews because of their disobedience, because of them rejected Christ. Amen. Here it is. Jesus is putting a warning out here for the church. He is showing a condition that was going to affect the church. He says, immediately after tribulation of those days, 29th verse in the 24th chapter, shall the sun be darkened, the moon shall not give her light, and the stars shall fall from heaven, and the powers of heaven shall be shaken. And there shall appear what?
Sign.
Of the Son of Man in heaven. Now, I want you to understand. A sign is not the actual coming. If you have drove any expressway, amen, in America, and there is a sign, you get the sign before you get to your destination.
Amen.
And if you don't follow the sign, you won't make it to your destination. I don't know about you, but here it is. It might be a sign say, stay in this lane right here. Let me tell you something. Get off, get out that lane, can't get back over, and you don't miss your exit. Well, that's just how it is with life with so many today. They have missed their exit. Amen. They have erred. Amen. Gone off and compromised because you know what? They didn't take heed to the signs. All right. And then shall appear the sign of the Son of Man in heaven. And then shall all the tribes of the earth mourn. Wow. Let me tell you something. What caused the tribe to mourn? And who was these tribes? Well, it wasn't the 12 tribes of Israel, because they already had been rejected. Come on. Well, who is this? James 1 and 1. When James wrote his letter to the church, don't you know that the 12 tribe of Israel is a type of the New Testament church as well? Hello. How do you know? Because in Revelation, the Bible says, the 14th chapter, amen, that there was 144,000, 12,000 from each tribe. Now, we know more than that. Amen. We're going to heaven. But he took that number to be assembled to show us that it represented a people. How do you know? Because when he got to the end of that, he said, then there's a number that no man can number. You couldn't even count it. So here it is, when we are addressed as tribes, just like they had God's favor, let me tell you something. We, as the people of God, we have his favor. But just like they lost God's favor, when we don't obey God, we'll lose God's favor too. And we'll end up just like them. So here it is, we have a people, amen, or a condition, or of compromise and apostasy that set in right after the great tribulation or the destruction of Jerusalem, amen, that began to affect the church. That was AD 70. Let me tell you something. Jesus died on the cross, AD 33. Amen. That's about 47 years, somewhere along there, or 40 years is a generation in the Bible. One generation and the lofty place. Amen. When Jesus walked the earth, amen, and the 12 disciples, and they preached this truth, and the New Testament church was born. They were in a lofty or a heavenly position. Let me tell you, in less than 50 years, the spirit of apostasy had already begun to work. Paul even warned in his day, he said, oh, there was going to be a falling away. So look here. Here it is. We see here the sun darkened, the moon wouldn't give its light, the stars or ministers fell from the heavenly position, and the powers of the heavens of the church were shaken. Then there shall appear the sign of the Son of Man, and then shall all the tribes of the earth mourn. Now, just to prove my point, that the tribes of the earth is a symbolic expression directed to the New Testament church. James 1:1. What do James 1:1 say? Amen. James 1:1. Turn there. And when he was speaking to God's people, James, he addressed it. He addressed it to people. Listen to what he said. I got it. It said, James, a servant of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ, to the 12 tribes which are scattered abroad. My brethren. He called them brethren. Come on. Amen. He said, count it all joy when you fall into divers temptation. See, after the destruction of Jerusalem, amen, they caused the church, amen, to scatter. Because guess what? For the most part, the temple of Jerusalem was the place where they congregated. But they couldn't go there no more because the temple was destroyed. Jerusalem was burnt with fire. So guess what? Amen, they began to go everywhere. Preaching the gospel. Amen. So here he said, James, a servant of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ, to the 12 tribes which are scattered abroad, my brethren. Talking about the brethren.
Amen.
Amen. The saints, count it all joy when you fall into divers temptation.
Amen.
Then he goes on and, you know what I mean, address them concerning other matters. So here it is. As we go through here and we look at the symbolism in here, and when we see what it signifies, we see some things here. And it goes on here, it says, and he shall send his angels. Let's see, make sure I didn't skip anything. Let me back up to the 30th verse again. And then shall appear the sign of the Son of Man in heaven. And then shall all the tribes of the earth mourn, and they shall see the Son of Man coming in the clouds of heaven with power and great glory.
All right.
Now, is that the actual coming, or is that symbolism too? Let me tell you something. You'll find in many cases, God traveled by a cloud. Yes, he did. How do you know? The tabernacle. He descended on the, he came many times to the children of Israel in a what?
Cloud.
cloud by day, cloud and a pillar of fire by night.
Right. Yes.
So sometimes when you use that expression, it doesn't necessarily mean what you think it may mean. Hello. You get to the book of Revelation, you see the angel with the sickle in his hand sitting on top of a what? Cloud. Come on. The New Testament church is called a cloud. Well, who makes up the cloud? All the saints from the Old Testament and all the saints in the New Testament make up one cloud. Why? It is that cloud that lifts up the glory of God. Can you prove that? Yes. Hebrews 12 and 1. Let's turn. Stick with me, you all. Hebrews 12 and 1. See, so sometime when we go in here, we have to break down the symbolism to understand what is he talking about? Who is he talking to? So look at 12 and 1. Wherefore, seeing we are also compassed about with what? So great a cloud of witnesses. Come on. Hello. Hebrews 12 and 1. Now, 31st verse. See, many cases when God would come to the children of Israel, amen, he would come to them in a cloud with power and great glory. He would descend upon the mountain in the cloud, and it would be thundering and lightning as he sat there. Hey, let me tell you something, Moses, let me tell you, the glory was so thick when Moses went up there into the cloud, amen, or the glory of God, he came down, he was shining, just full of the glory. Then put a veil over his face. So the 31st verse, and he shall send his angels, A-N-G-E-L-S, with a great sound of a trumpet. Now, as I said before, he never sent any angel to preach the gospel. Hello? Well, how do you know that he's talking about men? Revelation 8 and 2. Listen. Now, why are you getting there? I want to bring out another thought. You find that from the Revelation 8 and 2. And he shall send his angel with a great sound of the trumpet, and they shall gather his what? Elect. Church from the four winds. The Bible says, be not carried about with every wind of doctrine. Why? It is so many winds of, amen, of doctrine just blowing around in the spiritual realm, and we're not careful, we get all cut out. And when it says four winds, they're blowing in all directions.
Yes.
Come on. Hello. And he shall send his angels with a great sound of a trumpet, and they shall gather. See, God's message is either going to gather you to truth or it's going to scatter you. And it's no different. The message to the children of Israel was to gather them around so they could encamp and enjoy the glory of God and see the cloud in the midst.
Amen.
But when they rejected, amen, God got them a king and wanted to do things their own way, they ran the cloud off. So guess what? God scattered them. Hello. Now look here. Revelation 8 and 2. What is that?
And I saw the seven angels which stood before God,
uh-huh.
And to them were given seven trumpets.
were given what?
Seven trumpets.
Seven trumpets. Well, let's back up. Let's go to 8:1. And when he had opened the seventh seal.
And when he had opened the seventh seal, there was silence in heaven.
Well, what brought about a silence? In other words, they were no longer preaching truth. They was no longer sounding the message of warning. Come on. Hello. They backed off. They went silent on the message. The Bible said, he that make mention of the Lord, keep not silent.
Amen.
Ezekiel talk about the trumpet. If the trumpet blow an uncertain sound and it failed to warn the people, their blood was going to be on, you know what I mean, with the prophet hand, something to that nature. I think you all know what I'm trying to say. So here it is, we see in the book of Revelation, God's ministry. So it reads in the second verse, read on.
And I saw the seven angels which stood before God.
Where? They stood before God. Okay, go on.
And to them were given seven trumpets.
Uh-huh.
And another angel came and stood at the altar.
Oh, stood at the altar. So here it is. This is symbolism. Because what he wants you to do is get a picture of like what the tabernacle is. That was a golden altar where they were standing. And the angels or the ministry, amen, were standing there. So here it is, we see Christ
in
his priesthood. He was the angel because he was the one giving out the trumpets. Go on.
Having a golden censer.
He the one that had the golden censers in the hand, in his hand, which represent the prayers of the saints.
Yes.
Read on.
And there was given unto him much incense.
Amen. Much incense. That's the sweet odor of prayer. Sweet hour of prayer.
Yes.
Sweet hour of prayer that calls me from a world of care and bids me at my Father's throne.
Amen.
To make, all my wants and wishes and wishes known, something like that. And since he bid me to seek his face, believe his word, and trust his grace, I'll cast on him my every care.
Yes.
Amen. Oh, Lord. Sweet hour of prayer.
Yes.
Come on. That incense represents the prayers of God's people. So we see Christ in his priestly duty. And he's at the golden altar. And he's putting fire in your prayers. Amen.
Yes.
In other words, you see, amen, that we are to pray in the power of the Holy Spirit. Come on. And so here's a ministry, amen, that is around the altar. And if you want to know if the ministry is of God, amen, listen to his trumpet. How did he get the trumpet? He was in the right place. He was where the high priest was, amen, at the golden altar. Read on.
That he should offer it with the prayers of all saints.
Uh-huh.
Upon the golden altar,
yes,
which was before the throne.
Uh-huh.
And the smoke of the incense, which came with the prayers of the saints, ascended up before God out of the angel's hand.
Uh-huh.
And the angel took the censer and filled it with fire of the altar, and cast it into the earth. And there
That's a beautiful symbol expression of the day of Pentecost. Amen. And that's just what happened. He poured out the fire into earthen vessels. Go on.
And there were voices and thunderings and lightnings and earthquakes.
Ah, so here it is, where there's trumpets. Amen. And where there's the high priest, there's thundering and lightning and earthquakes. And see all the symbolism? So here it is. Well, Christ is the one who wrote the book of Revelation. He sent and signified it by his angel. What it means, signified? He put it in symbol. Well, here's the same Jesus Christ preaching his message on the end time coming. In the 20, really, this is one, like one complete message. Amen. The whole 24th chapter. preaching a sermon on what it's going to be like in the end. And so that's what God is doing. He's sending his preachers out with the sound of a trumpet. And their message is different. They don't have the same message as Babylon. Come on.
Amen.
Amen. Then he goes on here, now learn the parable of the fig tree. When its branch is yet tender and put forth its leaves, you know that summer is nigh. So likewise, when you shall see all these things, know that it is near, even at the doors. Verily I say unto you, this generation shall not pass till all these things be fulfilled. What generation? Well, the Bible said, now is accepted time. Now is the day of salvation. So the day of salvation is one long day. Come on. So this generation he's talking about is the gospel generation. And that's, this generation of the gospel has been going on for about almost 2,000 years. Hello? So here it is. This coming, a lot of this that is written here, it has nothing to do with what you think it does. But do you believe Jesus Christ is coming? Yes, I do. Do you believe that the church is going to be called up? Yes, I do. Do you believe that we shall all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye? Yes, I do. Amen. That's what the Bible teaches. Yeah. Amen. Are those literal events? Yes, they are. Amen. And he's telling us that if we read down here, amen, through, amen, his message here. But he's also showing us what happened to the Jews and what has happened to the church. Because guess what? Afterwards, see, there was a three-part question. He began to show the other signs. Question three, when shall be the end of the world? Note, immediately after the tribulation of those days, the tribes of the earth shall mourn. The Son of Man coming in the clouds of heaven with power and great glory. We just brought that out. The sounding of the trumpets by the angels. He sent his angel with a great sound of the trumpet. And the purpose of them is to warn the people and to gather his church, his elect from the four winds of heaven. All right? He said, now learn the parable of the fig tree. In other words, just like a parable, when it puts forth its tender leaves, amen, you know that summer's nigh. In other words, they can tell, amen, what the season was by the fig tree, for example. So here it is. He simply telling us we should know the signs of the time by the conditions that we see, amen, in the church world. Come on.
Amen.
But the actual coming, the day and hour, knoweth no man. No man don't know it. No angel don't know it. Only the Father. So when I look at this and I begin to read down through here, I begin to see some things. One thing to note about all these signs is that they all exist right before us this day. We are only waiting for its coming. The sign of the Son of Man in the clouds of heaven and great glory, the tribes of the earth shall mourn, the angels, the ministry of the messenger, the trumpet, the preaching of the gospel, the gathering, that's the come out call from the church. Well, where was he gathering from the four winds? Well, where's the four winds blowing? In Babylon. Every wind of doctrine. God wants his people brought out from those states. Who's the elect? That's the church. Those that are chosen. And when he calls us out, he calls us to something. We're not just called out of false religion and just left to ourselves. We're called together. And look here. Here's some of the signs. The sounding of the trumpet, which we just finished talking on. And it's as it was in the days of Noah. Then the sign of the two women gathering together, two women in the field and two women grinding together at the mill, is a type of the true church and the false church. The true church shall be taken, all right? All right, then it goes on the fourth sign, the good man of the house, amen, and the house broken up. That's talking about the church, amen, and division. The fifth sign, the 10 virgins, because the whole message go right into the 24th and the 25th chapter is one complete message. Then the sixth one, the servant, in other words, the responsibility of stewardship. And then you get down here to the day of judgment. The sheep and the goat. So here it is. We just need to know what he's talking about. It's not hard. It takes some studying. But I see this as I see the book of Revelation. And the reason why most of these people don't understand it because the book wasn't written for them. You understand? It was written for his servants. Everybody ain't a servant of his. We can't live a life of sin and live like we want and be a servant and expect to understand the letter. Because the letter ain't written for us. So we're going to end it right here. And we're going to start up, Lord willing, broadcasting next week to kind of complete this series. But the series consist of let's see, quite a bit, but what it does, it addresses most of the issues, the false issues out here today. You know, yes, we are going to be caught up with him to meet him in the air, but that's it. Then we're going to be with him. There's not going to be earth here to stand on, because the last trump is sounding when we are caught up and the dead in Christ are caught up and we which are alive, we caught up together. And then when you read in Peter, amen, and you read in 1 Corinthians, all those same scriptures harmonize with that one event. There's not several different events. When Christ comes, he's coming back to take us home. Amen, and that's it. So if all the saints are gone home, you tell me, who's going to be down here to preach the gospel? You can't preach the gospel unless you're saved. And if the earth is being burnt up at that same time, where are you going to stand on to preach? Ain't going to be no planet here, so what's what it is? All right, then. So we're going to leave it right here for now. Thank you for watching. I am Pastor Rick of the Church of God in Chesapeake. If some things you don't agree with or you don't see, you're more than welcome to get in contact.